Who doesn't love cookies? This is a recipe that's going to be very straightforward. You're gonna wow everybody who has these cookies. You are going to learn all of the tricks of making the best cookie of your life. Let's get started. Let's start with the really basic, which is mise en place. What that means is gathering everything in its place before you start the recipe. So I start with the chocolate. With a chef's knife, I'm just gonna take this chunk of chocolate and cut down like this. So I'm gonna make sure all of the chocolate is about half an inch to an inch in size. For me, a chocolate chunk is what I want when I'm eating a chocolate chip cookie. Place your bowl on the scale and then you press tear, and that zeroes it out so that it doesn't take into account the weight of the bowl. I'm gonna start measuring till I get about 255. So I have 255 grams of chocolate. Can you imagine if I tried to figure out how many cups this is? Like if you chop your chocolate really small, and then if I chop it kind of big, we're gonna end up with two totally different amounts. I weigh everything. I'm going to tear again, so that zeroes it out. Now I can add milk chocolate. I'm just gonna start shaving it down. This one's a little bit easier to cut because it's softer. I need about 70 grams, so I've teared the scale. 72, almost perfect. So now we have our 255 grams of dark chocolate and about 70 grams of milk chocolate. Now we've got my second bowl, 150 grams of granulated sugar. This is 3/4 cup. I'm just gonna measure this out. And we've got our 150. And then in the same bowl, I'm gonna measure the brown sugar. Tear that. Now brown sugar is a great example of why we want to use a scale rather than a measuring cup. It looks like it's taking up this much room in the bowl, but you can pack it down. So that means that if you're measuring brown sugar using a cup measurement, if I'm measuring brown sugar using a cup measurement, we might end up with two totally different measurements, depending on who packs down the brown sugar more. So that's why we measure with a scale. In the same bowl, 165 grams of brown sugar. The next thing we're gonna measure out is our dry ingredients. I'm gonna start out with a nice big bowl. Remember to tear so that you start back at zero. High gluten bread flour, 160 grams. By measuring everything out with a scale, it also just makes things so much easier. You don't have to have multiple cup measures. You can just go ahead and dump everything straight into the dry mix. I actually like a cookie that has a little bit of like thickness and a little bit of chew. So we've added the high gluten flour. I'm gonna tear that again. Now we have your basic all-purpose flour, 150 grams. So now we've got the flour measured. We're going to add a teaspoon of baking soda. Now with stuff like baking soda, we're using these items, these ingredients in such small measures that the scale doesn't really register. I go with the teaspoon measure. So we've got a teaspoon of baking soda. We have a half a teaspoon of kosher salt. So I have 2 large eggs, and these are at room temperature, and you're gonna crack them directly into a small bowl. Then we're gonna add 1 teaspoon of vanilla extract. I don't want little pockets of egg yolk to be in the mix, so I'm gonna whisk it all together to try to create something that's a little bit homogeneous. The eggs are at room temperature because when we are going to mix the cookie dough together, we're going to spend a lot of time creaming that butter and sugar together. The butter is going to start to soften. It's going to get aerated with all of the sugar. If the eggs are cold, as soon as the eggs hit the butter and sugar, it's going to cause the butter to firm up. We're going to cream the heck out of it, make it really light and fluffy. Let's put together this dough. We're going to start with unsalted butter. The ideal temperature when creaming butter and sugar, when you have a stick like this, is that you can bend it. First, mixing up the butter and then adding the sugar. If you buy salted butter in the grocery store, there are different brands and you really don't know how much salt has been added to the butter. Creaming butter and sugar, that is not a step that you want to skip. It adds such a huge difference to the texture of the cookie so that you get that really nice, light, chewy texture. If it gets to the point where the butter is so warm that it starts to melt, all of those air pockets start to collapse. After you've put the butter in the mixing bowl is to then add the sugar. We've got both the mix of the brown sugar and the white sugar. We're gonna go ahead and get started. Let's start this at a slow speed. It should take about 3 to 5, maybe 8 minutes to get this beautiful, fluffy butter and sugar mixture. Basically, the term creaming butter and sugar together is when you mix butter and sugar together and keep mixing it and mixing it and mixing it until it lightens in color. In fact, it turns to almost the color of like heavy cream, which is how it gets its name, creaming butter and sugar together. Now, why is that so important? If you were to have a microscope here and take either the brown sugar or the white sugar and look at it under a microscope, you know that sugar is a crystal. Now, these hard crystals, when they go into your softened butter, are basically aerating your butter. I'm gonna take a spatula and really get into the bowl. A lot of times, the butter will collect, make sure that it gets loosened so that it can all get creamed together with your sugar. Imagine all of those sugar crystals creating all of the air in the butter. And just let your mind relax a little bit. Just in case there's any last bits that I didn't get the first time, I usually do this about twice. Now these eggs are, again, at room temperature. So I'm gonna turn the mixer on, kind of a low speed, slowly drizzle it in so that it has time to fully mix in to the butter and sugar. Great, now the egg and the butter and the sugar are all mixed in. So it's not gonna be quite as fluffy because we've added a little bit of egg, but it should be kind of creamy looking. And you don't want pieces of egg mixed in with pieces of butter. You really want it to be kind of homogeneous because if it's separated, then when the dry ingredients hit it, then the dry ingredients are gonna latch onto the egg and they're gonna latch onto the butter and you're gonna end up with weird little pockets. I'm gonna give it another scrape. Make sure we get all of that. And this is looking really beautiful. Now, I did want to show you, you can see, like when I cracked the egg, there was a little bit of eggshell. So this is why we crack into the bowl and then pour the eggs, because if this ends up in somebody's cookie, have you ever had a cookie with eggshell? It's like, you'd think it wouldn't be so bad. You'd think it'd be nice and crunchy, but it's pretty nasty. Great, let's now mix our chocolate in with the flour. So the reason I mix the chocolate into the flour is that that way I can combine the flour into the egg, sugar, and butter mixture with minimal gluten development. Because remember, the gluten will start developing as soon as the flour hits anything liquid. I like to mix this part with the mixer, and then I like to finish it by hand because I don't want to overmix. If I were to turn this on, all the flour would go everywhere. So I'm just gonna pulse on, off. So I've mixed it pretty much all the way, but I'm actually gonna finish mixing it by hand. I like to finally feel the dough. I've let the machine do everything and now I wanna do something. So let's go ahead and take this out. And then also it allows me to control how much mixing we're doing so that we don't overwork the dough. Butter and sugar both inhibit gluten development, so I'm not too worried about getting a cookie dough that's gonna be tough, but as I'm mixing, I make sure it's all been mixed in, and now it's ready to go. Now, this chocolate chip cookie dough, you don't want to bake it right now. These will be 1,000 times better if you let the dough rest overnight in the fridge. That flour is gonna absorb more of the liquid that's in the eggs and in the butter, and it's gonna bake off into a much better cookie. So take your dough and scrape it into an airtight container. Take the time to rest the dough. What that does is it hydrates the flour so that you end up with a really beautiful, thick chocolate chip cookie. And now we're gonna scoop and bake these cookies. We're gonna go ahead and put about 6 cookies per tray. I like to place them 2 to 3 inches apart. They're gonna spread a little bit, so you do wanna give them a little bit of room. Ideally, you're gonna wanna bake 1 cookie tray at a time, because that way you'll have even airflow above and below the cookie sheet. Your cookies will bake off nice and evenly, but let's be real. You've got 2 cookie sheets. Are you really gonna wanna wait? So I won't be upset if you bake 2 at a time. Just know that if you really wanna do this perfectly right, you should bake 1 at a time. Now that I've got my cookies scooped, we're gonna go ahead and go to the oven and start baking our cookies. Make sure you have an oven thermometer so that you know that the oven is actually at 350. So let's go ahead and go to the oven. At the end of the day, you are in your kitchen looking at your product, working with your oven. And so I really want you to learn how to bake by sight and by touch. Even though you might have an oven thermometer that says 350, my oven thermometer says 350, there's so much variation in ovens. The oven isn't just staying at a static 350. What happens is the oven's triggered. Once it goes below a certain point, the heat kicks in again, and then it brings it up a certain point. And so ovens kind of waver between 10 degrees, 5 degrees, it depends on your oven. So I just pulled these amazing chocolate chip cookies out of the oven, and I'm gonna let them rest here for about 10 minutes before I take them off and put them on the cooling tray. I think we should try some of the warm cookies. Oh my gosh. Is your cookie like this? There's like gooey milk chocolate and gooey dark chocolate inside. And so let's go ahead and What am I looking for? You can see visually, your cookies are golden brown, it's pale in the center, but they're totally cooked through in the center. If you pull them out too early, you're gonna end up with this little pocket of raw dough. It won't be the end of the world, but ideally you want the cookie to be baked all the way through. For me, the perfect chocolate chip cookie is kind of balanced with a lot of chocolate flavor. It's got a crispy edge, it's got a tender melt-in-your-mouth center, and it's got big pieces of chocolate all throughout. There's also a little hint of molasses. It's from the brown sugar and a little caramel from the milk chocolate. And then there's just a little bit of salt. We put in that kosher salt into the recipe, and you can actually taste a little hint of salt. It's not salty by any means, but it's enough salt to really draw out the flavors of the butter, the vanilla, and all of the chocolate. They are definitely best eaten day of that you bake them, but if you store them, they should last about 2 more days in an airtight container. So now you've become a star cookie baker. If you really want to improve your cookie baking, there's one simple trick. Just keep making cookies. And who's going to complain about that? Making cookies over and over again, you will get so much practice and you will learn how every single little adjustment you make changes the result of the cookie. And you'll be able to fine-tune your own technique so that you can be the best cookie baker ever.